The subject is georeferencing, and I'll go into detail about what I mean by that. What I need to tell you is that in this course, if we're lucky, we'll have maybe 2 hours to spend on this subject. Now, normally, there's a 5-day course given on georeferencing in order to make you expert enough to actually go out, do it yourself, teach others how to do it. So we're only giving you a very brief introduction to the subject in the hopes that you'll understand its complexities and appreciate how much work it could be, how much you need to know to do it well. So I'll get right into that now. The first presentation that I'll give you is the very first presentation that's given in a 5-day seminar on the subject. These 5-day seminars are really working workshops. In other words, a lot of exercises. We get people working with paper maps, with different software, with each other to understand the full process associated with georeferencing. So what exactly is georeferencing? I'll talk about it now in relation to its basic concepts, how collaborations can help to make the job go more efficiently, and talk a little bit about automation to also make the job go a little bit more efficient. So, three different basic subjects within this talk. Georeferencing itself and what it is, how collaborations can help, and how automation can help. So first, georeferencing. What is georeferencing? So this is the simplest description that I could come up with, and that is that it's a numerical description of a place that can be mapped. So now we're really getting into putting occurrence records on maps, rather than mapping fields between a database and a record. So the kind of mapping we were used to before this morning. So that is to say that we have generally records that look something like these. We have some kind of an identifier, which might be a catalog number, a lot number, a session number. We have some kind of a notion of a species, a scientist's name, some kind of, and a location. A lot more, obviously, but this is the basics of what it is that we have. So our descriptions are, our locality descriptions are just that, descriptive. They generally don't contain information that can be mapped directly. And we need to change that. We need to turn that into mapping data. So we've already gone through Darwin Core in fairly good detail. For the purposes of georeferencing, we're talking about location terms. We're talking about location terms either on the interpretation side to figure out where something is, or location terms for georeferences that we're going to create, the decimal latitudes, longitudes, and all the metadata that we're going to accomplish. So, definitely looking almost entirely at the Darwin Core location terms. What we want in the end is to be able to map species, or to go further and do things such as in the workshop next week, species management. So much of your work to be done in that course is made possible by the hard work of georeferencing in the way that you're about to describe. So, specifically Darwin Core georeference terms, that is the kind of the terms in Darwin Core that we want to be able to populate. Aren't populated to begin with, are these. The very basics are the decimal latitude and decimal longitude. In Darwin Core, we have places for the Bayesian coordinates in various lines, but those are a lot harder to deal with than the standardized and simplified version that has one word for latitude, which is the decimal between minus 90 and positive 90, and one for the longitude between minus 180 positive. In addition, because, as it turns out, that's insufficient information to place a point on the surface of the Earth, we need something called a geodetic data. I'll talk about that in a moment. also, in order to make the data more useful, and that is to allow researchers to know whether a particular record is fit for use, we add further information in the form of coordinate uncertainty in meters. I'll show you what that means in a minute. But it, basically, it's a way for us to assess how specific is our georeference. And then we have information about who did it, what rules they followed, what sources they used, and how well the information was verified afterwards. And finally, we add whatever remarks are needed to describe what we did that might have been out of ordinary, assumptions that we made, for example. So all these are fields in the Dharma 4. They all have the purposes, and hopefully you'll have time to describe each of them in detail. But I still need to tell you what is a georeference. I said that it's a numerical description of a place that can be mapped. And you might guess from what I just showed you that it has something to do with latitude and longitude. Let me give an example. This is one way of georeferencing, which we call the point method. It consists of a coordinate pair, in this case, in decimal latitude and decimal longitude. So we're in the northern hemisphere and the western hemisphere. And this thing I just alluded to a moment ago called the geodetic data. So the combination of these three pieces of data, latitude, longitude, and data, actually do describe a single point on the surface of the Earth. It happens to be at the center of this X. Okay? That's the point. Now, I have to talk a little bit about the inequality. We don't know in advance, when we're about to share data, how the users of those data might actually use them. They might be used in ways that we don't foresee, either as curators of the data or as the collectors of the data to begin with. And so our assumptions and the way that we collect our data may affect how usable those data are for the data online. Let me give you a very quick and simple example. Suppose I'm a researcher who relies on my automobile, drive along the highway, see things along the highway, and collect them. Or I rely on my automobile, and I have a little bit more energy than that, and I get out of my automobile, and I walk from the highway up into the bush for up to a kilometer collecting things. Now, for my own purposes, I may be interested to know where I need to get out of the car in order to go find another one of those things that I just picked up. And so I would record the location of where I parked the car. And everything I collect is within a kilometer of there or less. Okay? I have my own preconceived notion of how the data would be useful. But there could be a researcher down the road when my data becomes public. Who's actually interested in a much more specific location from the record, because off the side of the road there are microhabitats, like streamlets, and different riparian and music habitats. And that might be interesting to the next researcher, who doesn't just want to go and get in the neighborhood and see if they can find more of what they like. So the value of the data is directly related to how well it can be used in the future, how many different kinds of uses it can be put to. In that sense, what we want to achieve as data capturers, data publishers, is to be as complete as possible and to be as clear as possible about what it is that we're capturing. So, it has become apparent as data become published that people will use them in new and interesting ways. In Georgetown, town, we'll be happy to give you plenty of examples about how data are misused because people don't understand and don't pay attention to how those data are collected and what they actually mean. So the idea here is, you know, georeferencing processes to do as well as we can to add useful information about the uncertainties associated with the descriptive data. So I will posit then that a new definition that is of a acceptable georeference is one that not only is a numerical description of a place that can be mapped, but also describes the spatial extent of that place and its associated uncertainties. In other words, it's not just a point. A point doesn't tell me how uncertain it is. Okay. So, what's an example of that? Well, a bounding box is one such way to do that. What I'm doing here, by capturing two coordinate pairs, latitude and longitude for one end, and latitude and longitude for the other end, is describing a box. Don't forget the data. Describing a box within which this locality must have occurred. Remember before, my point method had just a little cross over here. And that was for the same place called Davis in Yolo County in California. But here, the bounding box, you can see, actually surrounds everything that, at least at that time, was the town of Davis. You can see here on the map. So the bounding box captures the idea of the extent of the place, whereas the point did not. The point didn't tell me where in Davis, it didn't tell me how big Davis was, it didn't tell me how uncertain I am when I put a point on the map to describe Davis. The bounding box takes care of that problem. It gives me limits within which that locality occurs. An alternative method is this one, called the point radius method. It's similar. Inside of it is supposed to be Davis, all of Davis, but it's described slightly differently than the bounding box. In this case, it has just one coordinate pair, latitude and longitude, and that coordinate pair is for the center of the circle. We still have a datum, because that's required to give us a unique place on the Earth. And then we have this different attribute, which we call, at least on the slide, a maximum uncertainty, or in Darwin core, this is called the coordinate uncertainty in meters. So now, unlike the bounding box, we have only a single coordinate and a distance measure, an actual length, rather than two coordinates without a length. So two different ways to achieve the same purpose, to completely circumscribe the place and capture the extent of the uncertainty. I'm going to go one step further and say what's an ideal georeference, and that is everything that I said before. It's a numerical description. It describes a spatial extent, and it does that as well as possible. Okay, so how can we do as well as possible? You can imagine that the bounding box and point radius both had one slight shortcoming. Both of them over-described Davis. They included all the stuff on the outside just because of the shape of their geometry. The bounding box, by definition, was a rectangle, but Davis is not a rectangle. So the bounding box that included Davis included a lot of things that were not Davis also. The same is true of the circle. So, if I want to be as specific as possible about what Davis is, I'd be better off using something like the shape method, which is a geometry or polygon that describes the outline of Davis. Everything inside the polygon is Davis, and everything on the outside is not. That's a better method. That's a more specific method. It's not the only one. There's this one too. The graphic is a little confusing. Let me say this only, and that is that it is a probability description of the same kind of thing as the shape method that takes into account all the uncertainties that we might have, all the sources of uncertainty that we might have. So this is a slightly different kind of locality. You can see it's not just a named place, such as Davis. It's actually some distance in some direction from a named place. So a whole bunch of other sources of uncertainty come into play here. Before, with Davis, it was just the uncertainty of the size of Davis that mattered. Now, we have an uncertainty of what does it mean to be east. We have an uncertainty of what does it mean when it says 20 miles. Is that somewhere between 10 and 30? Between 15 and 25, between 19 and 21, between 19 and a half and 20 and a half. Doesn't make a big difference in terms of where the location is. The idea behind this slide is to show you that there is an alternate method to the shape method, which includes what you see shaded here, and that's a probability surface, saying wherever it's darker is a more likely place to be 20 miles east of Newport. And the less, the lighter places on the outskirts are less likely to be 20 miles east of Newport. You can see that this has something of a shape of the original, the yellow here is Newport, and this is going east, and you get the shading based on how far away we are.